I've been in the industry now for 35 years doing chocolate work, ice creams, pastries, desserts, across the board. So working in from England, France, Singapore, Italy. I've represented Australia 3 times in World Cups. So I've got a little bit of knowledge and I've seen a few different things and I've had a lot of problems. With chocolate in different countries, humidity and heat are the main things that chocolate doesn't like. Humidity because the water gets into the product. When it does get into the product, this is a good one, fresh bag. This has been set to a little bit of humidity and a little bit of heat. It's exactly the same chocolate, it's just got, how should we put it? Manky. This will melt, but it will melt like a paste. If you keep heating it, all you're gonna do is burn it. That's all right to make a mousse or chocolate sauce or something like that. Nothing wrong with it. You'll get problems with your chocolate. You'll get a fat bloom or a sugar bloom. A sugar bloom will be rough on the outside. That's where the moisture's got to the chocolate and drawn through hygroscopic action, taking the sugar out of the chocolate. A fat bloom is where it's got warm and cool and warm and cool, and the fat's coming to the surface. Okay, so we're gonna melt the chocolate in stages. The cheaper microwave, as I said, is better. Make sure the turntable's going, especially when you're putting the white chocolate in there. Don't put the white chocolate in for 3 minutes and walk away. You'll soon work out at what temperature it's gonna burn. That's 3 to 5 minutes is more than enough time. So if I put in for 3 minutes to start with, notoriously white chocolate burns. White chocolate is not chocolate. I don't know why we call it chocolate. It's vegetable fat, milk solids, lecithin, and sugar. There's no chocolate in there at all. So the reason we only microwave it in stages, once it starts to burn, it burns really quickly. It smokes, it burns a hole in your plastic bowl, and then you can't get the smell out of the microwave for weeks. Why are we using plastic bowls and not porcelain? Plastic bowls are great because once your chocolate's finished and set, you can just bend, it'll crack the bowl out because chocolate contracts. Don't believe me? Chocolate contracts? Of course it does. How can I prove that? That's just a thin sheet of chocolate that's contracted. So the chocolate's drawing itself in and it's pulled up the paper. Okay? So people say, how do you mold chocolate? That's another class. That's even more fun. That's how we get the chocolate out. The chocolate's contracting, so that's pulling itself together. That's why it's made it from a flat sheet to a curved sheet. So when the chocolate's set, we can just crack it out. If we want to use a ladle, I'm going to use a plastic ladle for the same reason. Plastic spoon for the same reason. Once it's cold, crack it off. We don't have to try and scrape everything. I'm lazy. So I've pulled it out, I've stirred it, I'm stirring it again, just to make sure the lumps are good. I don't want to take that above 35 degrees, because anything I do make is gonna get too hot, and then we're gonna have problems. There's still a few lumps in there. Stir it, let it set. Taking the temperature, if I just go beep, I know it's 29 degrees, but that's not the correct temperature. If you have a probe, put the probe in, you'll get the center. So as I'm stirring it, then I'm going to take the temperature. So it was 29 degrees. It's actually now saying it's 36. So that's good. But I know what the real temperature is. I know that's quite warm. My body's at 27.6. So I go, yep. In the old days, we used to use our lip because that's a nice sensitive part of your body. But health and hygiene, we've stopped doing that. So your forearm's good. You could use it like an elbow with the baby water, but you're gonna end up with chocolate elbows. White chocolate. Cut the temp or the power down. I'm gonna set it for 2 minutes. Gonna press start, take it out, turn it over, check it, turn it over, check it. Minute by minute by minute. So we wanna do some colors. We wanna make something pretty. Why do we want to make stuff that's pretty? Because our desserts need a little bit of color on them. You've got a chocolate mousse or something. It's brown, 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 brown. I don't want to put a fan strawberry on it. I don't have time. I can't get them. I want to put some color, some chocolate decoration. If you want to go for something chocolatey, make sure it's not thick. There's nothing worse than having a chocolate dessert and you've got this great big chunk of chocolate. So thin is better. Queen natural cochineal. Cochineal, where does that come from? Ooh. Bugs, originally anyway. So this is liquid. It's not really gonna help putting on my paper, all it's going to do is stick together. So what I've got to do is I've actually got to spread that out. And before I go any further, because I know what's going to happen, I'm going to end up with even worse food colouring stains than normal. As you can see, as I start to spread the chocolate around, it's starting to form little droplets all over. So if I get the chocolate on it to spread it, I need to be able to push those droplets around. So those little globules, another favorite word of mine. Can't see much. That had like, oh, I don't know, how much liquid was on there? Next to nothing. It looks like I'm just spreading the paper around. The chocolate I apply to this now, I keep the small palette knife, and I'm going to spread from one back to the other. So I'm pushing as hard as I can onto the paper without breaking the palette knife. Because what's going to happen is it's going to force the liquid into the chocolate. And it gives us quite a good effect. But as soon as it starts to get the liquid in there, and you can see by my finger how much pressure I'm putting on there. Because it's white on that knuckle, the pressure that I'm putting on is immense. I am so massive. It's probably the most workout I've had all day. Dry your palette knife off. I can't stress this enough, so make sure you're not getting any liquid anywhere. I'm not washing my hands, I'm just wiping them off. I'm not getting any liquid on the knife, I'm wiping it off. That's set straight away. There is liquid underneath, but it's now sort of sealed off. The chocolate I put on top is going to be a dark, and it's quite cool now, so that's not too bad. So it's still 2 spoons of chocolate to go on. Push the edge. I'm not going to go over the edge on this one because I don't want too much scrap. So I've got it spread, and then I'm going to go to the ends. That makes it nice and even. So how am I going to use this as a decoration? So it's setting here. I'm going to use my cutters. So you can choose the cutter size you want, whether you've got a large or a small one. If I'm cutting donuts, as it were, I cut the middle first and then the outside. Because if I cut the outside and then try and cut the middle, the chocolate gets forced out and it'll crack. A couple of large ones. Use metal cutters. They're a lot thinner and they cut through. The chocolate's not set. It's just starting to set off. So I've got a bit of time. And I'm cutting the chocolate where the chocolate is set. Tight as you can as possible. Turn the dirty ones upside down. Wrinkly's just starting to set now. Some long ones. Remember, your storage is important. So if you've got nowhere to store something that's this long, then think about what you're doing. Don't try and go oops, because something this long needs to be stored correctly. Trim off the ends, push it to set. I keep saying I've got time to cut it. I haven't got time. It's setting. What I mean is, compound chocolate sort of is hot and then it sets and then it sets and then it's crack. Couverture sets. Best pen ever. At a nice angle. So the compound chocolate's starting to set and then it sets. So it goes from easy to cut to hard to cut. So we haven't got the aircon in here. So what we've done is we've actually warmed it up, so it's about 26 degrees. So the chopper's taking longer to set, which is good. I've got longer to cut it. If I'm doing a big sheet, harder to handle, I haven't got time to cut it. There's a gel paste, a little bit easier than the cheap stuff. It's a little bit more expensive. That's the same amount of the cheap stuff I put on. This is blue chocolate. So I've got to spread that around again. It's easier to spread the gel than it was the liquid one. Probably half the amount of time. If I go nice and quick, you can see it. And I've got more down one end the other, so I'll turn that around and get that on. Make sure that I don't have any blue food coloring anywhere else, because there's nothing worse than going home looking like a smurf. A little bit of chocolate, just for decoration. Again, I'm forcing it through. I'm not gonna do it on every line either. So I'm gonna push that through. So you can use liquid, you can get away with it. Just not very good. The difficulty with this one is the liquid will continue to stay liquid. So you will end up with food coloring on the chocolate decoration, which is a little bit nasty because it'll get off on your fingers later. Push that down, swap that over, bring that back. So it's just starting to set. It's really thin, it'll set really quickly. A couple of spoons of chocolate. As you can see, it's melted back down again nicely. You can keep melting chocolate as long as it's nice and clean. You don't have a problem with it. Pull that forward. That was a good shot. Off the end. Clean up my mess, always clean. Now comes the exciting bit. Or as the kids say, the moment of truth. Okay, blue one first. This is the gel. Flip that over. I'm going to peel the paper off from one corner to the other corner. If you peel it off this way, it tends to flip up on itself. We'll see that in a second. So if I keep it nice and flat, it should stay on there without ripping. This is sticky because it's the liquid gel. I don't want the scrappy bits, so rather than going through the scrappy bits later, discard them straight away. This means put them somewhere where we can use them for a chocolate mousse and make kids' teeth go blue. Smurf mouth, as my daughter calls it. This one I'm gonna pick up this way. I've got my length here and I've got my discs here. I'm gonna get rid of some of the scrap before I flip it over. I'm gonna come up and then I'm gonna drop it down without bending it too much. If I bend it, I'm gonna break all the big ones. Corner to corner again. This is the cheap food color. These can be used as chocolate decorations on birthday cakes. So if you've got something that's sort of a little bit funky, a little bit different, and you've got a lot of birthday cakes you're going through, or you've got cakes that need something down the track. So these are really nice and thin. So that on top of a dessert with another one through the center. That'll actually stand up on its own on the dessert straight away. So I want to put on as minimum gold as I can because I don't want to waste it. With my lovely blush brush. So I put some on and just dab it on just so it starts to adhere before I go any further. And then with a circular motion, I'll make sure that it's buffed on. And then we'll go backwards and forwards just to come over it. This one is, I love this one, this is the peach. It comes, it's like a two-tone color. So a bit on the brush, again, same process. I'd rather put less than more. A So it starts off that sort of peach colour and then goes sort of a purple. So we're just going to peel that one off, same way. There's always one. Okay, so that's a little bit of chocolate work from TAFE Queensland. I'm glad you enjoyed it. Put it in your wine cabinet. Chocolate decorations, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, sorted. Happy days.